Once upon a time, there was a film crew that went to Brazil. Their mission was to shoot a movie about South America's second largest river, the Paraná. In order to get to this giant of over 3,000 kilometers, they had to fly across the Atlantic to a small, modest town called São Paulo, whose metro area has only 22 million inhabitants. Then they had to drive to yet another small town called Santa Fe do Sul, where the Paraná begins. Now, who were those people? Well, first of all, Christoph the Goldman, the sound guy, the man with the camouflage hat, and Life, the cameraman on the first part of the shoot. But as they moved on south, Rolling Ralph would operate the camera. In Santa Fe do Sul, local fishermen took them to the river. They connected all the cables and were ready to go. And before we forget the great director of the film, here he is. The guy who doesn't speak Portuguese.
Vamos a fazer dois takes.
We're ready. We're ready. I know.
So, why a film about this river? It's gigantic. Few people know about it. Its unique ecosystem is under a threat. We decided to portray the river and its people. Unnoticed by an international public, they struggle to preserve the Paraná. This is the movie's making of here on 5 Days, the world's very leading travel channel. In this video, you'll also get to see extracts from the actual film. Extracts like this one.
Der Paraná liegt in Brasilien weit ab der Großstädte an der Küste. Früher noch überquerten ihn die Fischer mit dem Ruderboot. An seinem Ursprung ist das seit Jahrzehnten anders.
Back when the fishermen crossed the river, there were no drones, also probably, but this information now is not certified by Google. The Paraná has become almost 10 kilometers wide here, due to the effects of hydroelectric power plants. Enormous dams leave their mark over most of the river's course. Local species are dying out in the river. Breeding tanks have taken over from traditional fishing. They breed fish like this here. Have you ever tried tilapia? It might well be from here. Local fishermen had to adapt to the new breeding culture. But Yoko Arita, for example, found a creative solution. She makes things out of fish skin, a residue mass production of tilapia simply throws away. And on we went with Rodrigo, our driver from São Paulo, through northern São Paulo state along the Paraná, which here feels more like a huge lake. There is plenty of water, but what is missing here in the area is forest. In this part of Brazil, there are only 3% of natural forests left.
So, aber jetzt ist hier wirklich, hier ist jetzt wirklich Schlange.
Hier kommt
Schlangengebiet.
Don't know about snakes, but this guy is here, the black lion tamarin, a rare monkey species that only exists in this area.
Um Arten wie das Rotsteißlöwenäffchen zu schützen, werden einzelne Areale in der Nähe des Nationalparks wieder aufgeforstet. Aber das dauert Jahre.
Despite all the evil snakes, we survived. But as you can see, only by chance. However, this experience led to a certain fearlessness among our crew. Next stop was a ranch of German descendants, a place about 2 hours east of the river, founded as a coffee farm many decades ago. Coffee farming was one of the factors that once started deforestation.
Es ist Bimini, das Anwesen der Familie Steidle.
The coffee farmer's grandson has reforested the area around his farm, which is supposed to serve as an example for all of Brazil. He even gives environmental classes showing how biodiverse life here could be if the woods were to return. But his ranch is massively surrounded by big monocultural soy fields, destroying the soil and damaging the environment.
Und erstmal Soja essen.
Back at the river, the Paraná shows a different face. We are close to the town of Porto Rico, where the river has not been affected by hydroelectric power plants. Ranger Enrique and his team showed us around. Nature here is still intact. And at sunset, the Puerto Rico River view is a true scenic delight. Even more so when it's carnival and people take their sound systems out.
Geil.
This is not Rio, but small town partying has its charm too. The next morning, we drove out to where the streets have no more names at all. To meet people from the landless workers movement who occupy land to make their voices heard.
In Brasilien ist es leider notwendig zu kämpfen.
In a country where 1% of the population own 50% of the land. The stories we heard here are about killed friends, evictions and constant threats, including from the current man in power. The last stop in Brazil was a coffee farm. Coffee farming still exists today. Here it has gone bio though. This farm can be visited by the public and it's not just tasty coffee, but also an interesting insight into an old tradition. Brazil, done. Next stop, Paraguay. Our infernal trio realized soon that the soy industry takes it to another level here, threatening these guys and their village. This is Ayapahu, inhabited by the indigenous Guarani people. Close to the river Paraná and protected by the few remaining forests, the Guarani can live their traditional lifestyle here. Which again does not necessarily include drones.
Manche sagen, Ayapahu ist die ärmste Gemeinde, aber aus meiner Sicht sind wir reich.
Also Dea, our driver in Paraguay, liked it here, but just outside of the woods, the soy industry is all over the place. The pressure on the indigenous community here is tremendous. At least they own the land they live on now, so they can't be driven out legally. Not everywhere the rainforests are gone. This is the Mbaracayú Reserve. One of the most important remaining forests in Paraguay. It covers 64,000 hectares. We follow two park ranges around, Sixto and Vidal. One of their most demanding jobs is to climb trees 30 meters high. Over 100 trees here are seed trees. Their seeds serve to regenerate rainforest all around Paraguay. And our two hotshots check on them on a daily basis. Hats off, buddies. Humans have changed the Paraná dramatically, but nowhere as dramatic as here. Itaipu is the second largest hydroelectric power plant in the world. In the 90s, the American Society of Civil Engineers called it one of the seven wonders of the world. The iron and steel used to build it would permit the construction of 380 Eiffel Towers. It provides 12% of the energy consumed in Brazil and 90% of the energy consumed in Paraguay.
Itaipu ist ein Besuchermagnet, vor allem abends. Auf beiden Seiten ertönt dann klassische Musik.
And many Instagram accounts explode, of course, due to fantastic hashtags.
Über 20 Millionen Touristen haben das Wasserkraftwerk seit 1977 besucht. Selfie-Time vor eindrucksvoller Kulisse. Auch das ist Itaipu.
It is also worth mentioning that for its construction in the 70s and 80s, 10,000 families living by the river were displaced. So far, that was a lot to digest for all of us. Life sent the drone to the skies one last time before he flew back home to Germany. And we and another guy.
Eine seltene Spezies in dieser Weltgegend. Paraguay hat er komplett mit dem Zweirad durchquert und über seine Reise ein Buch geschrieben.
This is Francisco Amarilla. We are next to the world-famous Iguazú Falls. I'll come back to them in a second, but what Francisco does is something special. He takes you on a secret falls tour of the beaten track. So if ever you decide to go to the Iguazú Falls, don't miss out on his tour. You'll learn about plants, animals, and can jump into the fresh water. This is the river Iguazú, which only a couple of kilometers later turns into gigantic falls. But don't just do what every other tourist does here and give this little trip to nature a chance as well.
Wir müssen echt aufpassen. Aufpassen, Moment.
Wenn das Ding da reinfliegt in diese Feuchtigkeit, dann gibt es einen Akku-Kurzschluss. Und dann war's das mit der Drohne.
Oh my god, the tension mounts. Will Rolling Ralph, the new cameraman, crash the drone into one of the world's most famous waterfalls? Well, first of all, we came here at 7 a.m. with not a single tourist around. A true privilege. Only an hour later, it's hordes of people with cameras. Now, back to the terrible suspense about the short circuit and the drone. Somehow, nothing happened. I mean, apart from the drone happily flying back to from where Ralph launched it.
Die Guarani nannten den Fluss, der sich hier in die Tiefe stürzt, Iguazú. In ihrer Sprache bedeutet I Wasser und Guazú groß.
I won't fight this, I think. But as we filmed from above, we also had to film from below. It was definitely Ralph's idea to go on the so-called Great Adventure Tour straight into the waterfalls. He never actually paid me a drink for this until now, and most images were never used in the movie, so here at least some outtakes. In the shadows of mass tourism at the falls, in the nearby city of Puerto Iguazú, this place only sees few visitors. The owner has taken used packaging materials to build a house. A solution for the poor, he says. Surprising and worth checking out. So, we're in Argentina now, in case you missed that part. Country number 3 on our cruise along the Paraná. We're in the northeastern province of Misiones and filming with an Argentinian showbiz star, Ingrid Krutke, a model that knows how to handle a tea harvesting machine.
Ich bin hier geboren, groß geworden, meine ganze, ich sag mein Fanche. Kindheit.
Nicolas came to join us as our driver in Argentina. Pretty soon he got his share of enormous dams and shiplocks on the Paraná. This is Yacyretá, on the border between Argentina and Paraguay. Ship crews spend days here on their way to the big Argentinian ports. Here also, it's a bit off the river where you find nature how it once was. Just outside of Concepción, these traditional cowboys called paqueanos take you around the huge wetlands out here, which are the second largest in the world. We dove in, but also had to take a look from above, obviously.
Ladies and gentlemen, the airplane.
Und Christoph, ist es so dein Fall? Ist es so dein Typ Maschine?
Ja, wenn ich mir so die Karosserie angucke, so viele kleine Hageleinschläge.
Und können wir nicht die Drohne nehmen? Oh.
This is Esteros del Iberá. It's kind of difficult to get here, but worth it. These are wetlands that are 273 kilometers wide. Biologist Thalia, the lady on the left, showed us around. Our little film crew, otherwise totally used to flying business class, was surprised to see which animals they are releasing back into the wild here. Like the jaguar, the king of the Paraná, which has disappeared from many areas. But don't you forget Alonso the anteater, who needs help from kind souls like Talia too. As we went further downstream, passing the nice colonial town of Goya, we felt the big international harbors coming. Finally, Ralph could sip on a good cup of mate, which is Argentina's national drink. And Christoph could reflect on his next novel, which might be called Lost in Santa Fe, or shipping all that soy to China. We reached the end of the Paraná, in the enormous delta outside of Buenos Aires. Out here, it's urban development versus protection of an ecosystem. It's a great place, and the megacity Buenos Aires seems far away. Still.
In Buenos Aires endet der Paraná. Nach seinem über 3000 Kilometer langen Weg durch Brasilien, Paraguay und Argentinien.
Prost auf den Paraná. Mit Paraná wassergebrautes Bier.
So the film crew returned to the old continent. But wait, there was one last stop. Back in Brazil, in Curitiba, we had a good night out at one of the city's best churrascarias. Not sure what their interpretation of the human stomach is, but it was a feast that seemingly never ended, a bit like the river itself.
Christoph, wie lange bleiben wir im Knast, glaubst du, nach der Nummer?
Ein paar Wochen, würde ich sagen, nur. Ich mach den Drohnentanz. Ich mach den Drohnentanz.
Thanks for watching. Be well and stay tuned.
Und jetzt ist aus. Boa noite, gente. A gente já foi.